Holy greetings, my much-loved brothers and sisters in the Lord, and praise be to Yahweh Elohim of Israel, who is good to his people, and this is what we live in, the richness of his goodness. Praise be to his name. A very warm welcome to the Keys of the Kingdom Holy Bible YouTube channel. The keys of the kingdom are truly jangling in these days, are they not? My name is Christopher Sparks. I'm the translator of the Keys of the Kingdom Holy Bible. This is a sober, serious, grammatical and organic literary translation of the scriptures of God, and it is a study Bible. It's available on my website in conjunction with the study companion to the Keys of the Kingdom Bible, my rationale, if you like to use a slightly academic word for why a new translation had to be made, a proper translation, organic, grammatical. And also this study booklet, Searching for Hell, which is the topic of today's talk. Now, those three are available together in a bundle on my website at a huge discount that the publisher is currently offering. So you can take advantage of that and get a massive discount on this. Now, hell is not a real place. Monday last week, I was in an interview with the delightful, charming English country gentleman, Richard Vobes, and we were talking about hell. And he entitled the video, Is Hell a Real Place? And we discussed the contents of my book. And last Tuesday afternoon, Richard uploaded this video. It's about an hour long. And I was coming back from a funeral in North Hampshire Tuesday afternoon, and I pulled into a lay-by wondering if Richard had uploaded it, and he indeed had. It was good timing. It had only been up 10 or 12 minutes or so, and already there were comments in the comments section. People already made up their minds. They weren't even going to listen to any evidence. And by the time a couple of days had lapsed, one or two people sent me screenshots of comments, and one of them, somebody said, Richard and his guest should go to hell. So there was somebody wishing that Richard Vobes and Christopher Sparks should suffer in eternal agony in fire without forgiveness from God forever. Somebody else put, this is the best interview I have ever seen. So that's the range of the comments I saw. So now we're going to look at the evidence in slightly more detail than I went into with Richard. So first of all, somebody in 1997 brought to my attention that in the Old Testament, there is one word that is translated three ways, and in the New Testament, there are three words that are translated one way. Now, this fellow was getting at the hell translation and showing me the slightly devious agenda of the translators. He wasn't entirely right about three words one way in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, there is one exception, but we'll come to that. But he is right in principle, and it was a very helpful way of remembering it. And so we're going to look at those words in detail. But this whole idea of hell, somewhere you go after you've lived a sinful or selfish life, and you will be burning in agony forever, all this is embedded in our cultural images from artworks and poetry, and yes, in church Bibles. But should it be? And from all these, we get images of fires and devils and and grinning and orgies and caves and pitchforks, misery, demons, screaming angels, ogres, ridges, hunchbacks and grimaces, people in suffering. And this is embedded in our minds. And so it being so embedded in our minds from cultural icons, when we come to it in a translation or a perversion of the Bible, we have already accepted some kind of existence. And now the high end, the high art end of these cultural icons have come from great painters and poets. So artists such as Di Frusino and Gustave Doré, Hieronymus Bosch, and for poets, Homer, Dante, Milton, Blake, Shakespeare, and Chaucer to a lesser extent. Chaucer was more in passing, or as they say in French, en passant. In Shakespeare's Macbeth, there's a scene with a rather drunken porter, and he's imagining, as he hears the doors knocking, or the gates knocking, that he's a porter at the gates of hell. And I mean, it's just wonderful drama. Shakespeare is the master of drama. And so this porter, he hears a knock, and he says, "Here's a knocking indeed. If a man were porter of Hellgate, he should have old turning the key." So he should have plenty of turning the key. And then there's another knock. "Knock, knock, knock. Who's there in the name of Beelzebub?" "Here's a farmer that hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Come in time. Have napkins enough about you now, or have napkins enough about you. Here, you'll sweat for it." And then there's another knock. "Knock, knock, who's there in the other devil's name? Faith, here's an equivocator that could swear in both the scales against either scale, who committed treason enough for God's sake, yet could not equivocate to heaven. Oh, come in, equivocator." So, I mean, and on it goes. Remarkable, wonderful, wonderful drama. And he also has the phrase in there, of how the primrose way to the everlasting bonfire. But is it biblical? This is the issue. If it's biblical, then it's justified and something of it is true. If it's not biblical, the whole of it is fiction and a lie and a fraud, and the translations are useless perversions. If it's true, they are useful warnings. So, I can tell you, in 1979, December, God breathed his spirit into me, and I attended an evangelical church in East Hampshire, and there were four leaders. And the following year, one of them invited me to his home for supper, and he lived near Hindhead in Surrey. And close to Hindhead, remarkably, is a place called the Devil's Punch Bowl. And this man, I can remember his name, took me a walk, so 44 years ago, after supper, along the Devil's Punch Bowl. And then, remember, I was, you know, a brand new Christian attending this evangelical church, so I asked him about this hell thing. And he said, "Yes, it's true." So I said, "What about my parents?" Now, I'm here to tell you, everybody loved and adored my parents. They had multiple friends in the town. They were very well known and respected and loved. They were involved in many things: cricket, literature, drama, and local teaching, and a tennis club, and other things. And well, this man said to me, if they don't believe in Jesus, they'll go to hell. And I said, you know, but they're great people and they're full of love and they've been wonderful parents to me and my brother. And how can this be justified? So he said, well, when they're in hell, it'll be exposed what they're really like. Oh, well, at the time, I'd known them over 28 years. So I think I was in quite a good position to assess what they were really like. And now, years after their death, and me cracking up 74 next February, I have known them and about them for a long time. So I think I know what they're really like. Only once can I ever remember my father losing his temper. And it was a New Year's Eve or Boxing Day, perhaps, something like that. My brother and I were late teenagers, wanted to go to a party where he knew it wasn't the sort of party we should be going to. And it created a row. Now, my brother and I, you know, young teenagers, selfish little pigs, only think about yourself. And while this row was going on, my dad did actually shout at one point, and just then somebody walked through the back door, just let himself in. And as a contemporary, a friend of mine and my brother, and my father stopped and he said, "Hello, Neil, we were just rehearsing Hamlet." And everybody just burst out laughing. It was just wonderful. They were great people. So that was 1980, this man told me in the devil's punch bowl. My parents are going to hell because they don't believe what he didn't believe what he believed. Well, well. 11 years later, my father developed cancer. And I was praying for him. I had a dream that he was lost at sea out in the English Channel. And I was walking along the promenade at Southsea, which is east of Portsmouth Harbour. So in the dream, I was doing that. And in the dream, I was thinking, this means he's in hell. So I woke up discomforted. And so I was sobbing on my knees, which is a good way to pray, that God would deliver him from this. Sobbing, sobbing, sobbing. That's how much I cared. I didn't want that to happen to him. So then, of course, because I cared so much and I didn't want this stuff to happen and be true, yet I believed it was because it was in the Bible. Well, God took me down a certain path, which I will now give you the benefit of my studies. But the remarkable thing is, you know, that this person on Richard's channel should say Richard and his guest should go to hell. So unlike me in 1991, sobbing on my knees about a great man, this person wanted, even just last week, Richard Vobes and myself to suffer in eternal agony of torment. They don't like it when you tell them it's not true and it's false translating. They want it to be true. They do not want evidence in any other direction. They want hell for people. That's their character. And it is no delight to them to have it explained and exposed. Now, this character of a God who could torment somebody in utter screeching agony forever with no relenting, no forgiveness at any time, this is in conflict, actually, with my favourite verse in the Bible, which is Psalm 63, verse 3, which says, Your loving kindness is better than life. You might know a song entitled that. Your loving kindness is better than life. Your loving kindness is better than life. It's a good song. I like that. And that's the character of the God I believe in, who is good. And I have experienced his goodness over the last 3 days. It's just wonderful. And two things I really was not expecting. Praise God. Just wonderful. His kindness, reaching out. He's generous and he's a healer. He is magnificent. But according to some, he's like the tyrant Hades. Hades was the ruler of the underworld, and once you were in there, you were never let out. So, I will explain now what useless translators have done to the Word of God. First, we take the Old Testament. The Old Testament, if you don't know, is in Hebrew with some sections of Aramaic. Now, there is a Hebrew word which I know some of you will know well already and know all about. That's Sheol, with a lower S, because it's not a place name. It just means grave. That's all it means, grave. And by the principle of first occurrence, we can get some understanding of its meaning. Now, the first occurrence is in Genesis 37:35, and the first person to use it is the patriarch Jacob, whose house we are. Now, he thought his son Joseph was dead in Egypt, thought his son was probably torn to pieces by a wild animal. This was earlier. So he groaned that he'd go down to the grave in grief, mourning for his son. And it says, and all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted, and he said, for I will go down to the grave mourning for my son. Go down to the grave. That's what Sheol means. Now, you can paraphrase it with place of the dead or burial place if you want to, but grave is perfect. Sheol occurs 65 times in the Old Testament. 65 times. Now, in the King James translation or perversion, they translated it 3 times as pit. So 65 minus 3 equals 62. So 62 times remaining. Guess what the King James translators did with the remaining 62 occurrences of Sheol? They sat around in their committee. How are we going to translate this? So they decided, it's beyond belief as a translating principle. They split it in half. 31 times hell, 31 times grave. Oh yeah, that's a great way to translate a Hebrew word, isn't it? They did the same in Psalm 37 with Eretz, which means land. They translated it 3 times earth and 3 times land because they couldn't make up their minds. So they did not have solid translating principles such as there are in the Keys of the Kingdom Holy Bible. There are translating laws and translating targets and translating results, which is a discipline I impose. I do not split it 50-50 down the middle. So, in Isaiah chapter 14, Isaiah writes an ode, I call it, his ode to the king of Babylon. Now, I believe that king of Babylon to have been Nimrod, and it is not. Oh, tiresome Satan. It does not say Satan. It says the king of Babylon, and it doesn't say anything else. So another useless principle of exegesis. Oh, look, the king of Babylon. It's all about hell, so it must be Satan. It says the king of Babylon. Now, in my booklet, Searching for Hell, you see it's quite a thin book, about 90 pages. Isaiah 14, verses 9 to 15. Right, verse 9. The grave from beneath is astir for you to meet your coming. It stirs up for you the Rephaim, all the male goats of the land. It has flushed out from their thrones all the kings of the nations. So just like the other kings of the nations and male goats, leaders, rulers, cruel rulers, he also is going down into the grave, into Sheol. And so this is his fall from glory, that just like the rest, you're gonna die. Verse 11, down goes to the grave your pomp, to the sound of your harps. Underneath you is spread the maggot, and worms are your covering. Down goes to the grave, Sheol, again. Verse 15, yet to the grave you will be brought down, to the inmost recesses of the burial place. So grave and burial place, thereby the figure of parallelism, which is a form of repetition. We have it absolutely fixed that Sheol is grave. So we've got grave, 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 three times. Well, guess what the old King James translators did? They alternated it. So they thought they'd better get their hell in. So they put, instead of grave, 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 they put hell, grave, hell. So they kind of squashed grave in the middle. What sort of translating principle is that? The inconsistency. It is not internally harmonious. Now, my first translating law is grammar. My second is internal harmony. It must all be internally harmonious. And believe me, that is an almighty job. And another inconsistency. I mean, I've just pulled out some examples. I can't give them to you all. Psalm 49, verse 15. Now, where is it in my book? Page 16. No, 17. It says, Elohim will redeem my soul, or my life, for he will take me out of the hand of the grave. So he'll redeem me out of the grave. Psalm 86, verse 13, you have rescued my life, or my soul, from the lowest grave. Right, they mean the same, don't they? Rescued from the grave, redeemed from the grave. What's that about then? Yeah, resurrection. What does the King James do? Oh, well, again, let's split it down the middle. Psalm 49, verse 15, we'll put grave. Psalm 86, verse 13, we'll put hell. So, redeem my soul from the lowest hell. I wonder where that is. I think they'd been reading too much Dante's Inferno, the 10 circles of hell. And so that word soul or life is nephesh, which is the common Hebrew word for soul, Strong's H5315. Notice, you will redeem my soul from the grave. The soul does not fly off to other spaces. It goes into the grave because the soul is the person. That's another thing. Excuse me. So that's the Old Testament. showing you the, well, quite wicked agenda. Useless. Beni Belial. Anybody know what that means? That's Hebrew. Beni Belial. It means sons of uselessness. Now, in the New Testament, there are three words that we are concerned with. The first is Hades. The second is Gehenna. And the third is Tartaru. But first this Hades. And this is the equivalent of Sheol. It's the New Testament equivalent of Sheol. It means exactly the same thing. But what did the King Jimmy translators do to this? Well, they translated, it occurs 11 times. They translated it 10 times as hell. Gotta get a lot more hell in the New Testament, boys. And once as grave. In 1 Corinthians 15:55, because it was a citation of Hosea, which is plainly about resurrection, and they couldn't fiddle that one. So Hosea has got grave twice. And so what did they do? Did they get that right? Yes, they did. Yeah, Hosea 13, verse 14, grave, Sheol twice, and they've got grave, so good. So when it came to the citation in 1 Corinthians 15, they had to put grave. But the other 10 times, they put hell. Now, Peter on the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem, Acts chapter 2, this wonderful orator, Peter, and a man I think would have been my fishing companion if I'd been around in his day or he'd been around in my day. And he cited Psalm 16 because what was he preaching? The death and resurrection of the Messiah. That's what it was about. The Messiah has come, they killed him, and he has been resurrected. So Peter cited Psalm 16, verse 10 from King David, "You will not leave my nephesh in Sheol. You will not leave my soul or my life, my person, my being. You will not leave me in the grave." So Acts 2:27 and 2:31, Peter cites this. It's exactly the same. "You will not leave my corpse, dead body, self." So this nephesh, incidentally, in the Old Testament is sometimes used of corpse, a dead body. You can find that in Leviticus. Go to a concordance and look at all the uses of nephesh. It is also used of corpses, dead bodies. And so is its Greek equivalent, suchi, that is also used. So that is what we have here. But our main point is about the resurrection. "You will not leave my soul in the grave." Grave. Acts 2:27 and 2:31. His dead body, his soul, was not left in the grave. Peter proclaims resurrection. So the very next verse, 32. "This Jesus God raised up." So it's right next to his dead body, or his soul, was not left in the grave. "This Jesus God raised up." Where from? Out of the grave, out of death, because he really, really died. But what does the King James do? Psalm 16, verse 10, hell. Acts 2:27, hell. Acts 2:31, hell. Oh dear, resurrection is not from hell. It is from the grave. And hell does not mean the grave. We've already seen the distinction they make. And we'll see plenty more of that. So the King James Bible has another horrific blunder. Right, Jesus died. completely dead, he breathed out his last. That's what it says. And wouldn't you be dead if you had nails driven through you and you were hanged up on a cross or a tree, if you prefer? He was dead, stone dead, and the women went to look for him in the tomb. That's where he was. But the King James Bible has him in paradise, hell, and Joseph of Arimathea's tomb all at once. So Luke 23:43, it says, I tell you the truth, comma, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Well, he wasn't, was he? Because he was taken to Joseph's tomb. They put the comma in the wrong place. I tell you the truth today. That's a Hebraism. A Hebraic idiom. I'm here to tell you. I'm telling you the truth today. Moses uses it. You can find it. I think from memory, it's around about Deuteronomy 4, 5, 6, somewhere like that. It's footnoted in Keys of the Kingdom, I believe. From memory, I think. I'm pretty sure I did. So they got that wrong. Rang. And so we've just seen from Acts 2:27 and 2:31 that they also have him in hell. Well, that's rang. So where did he go? In the grave. In Joseph of Arimathea's tomb, Matthew 27, verse 60. So, but they've got him in three places. What a pig circus they made of it, didn't they? What a pig circus. Now, the second word, Greek word, is Gehenna. Now, this means Valley of Hinnom. But first we go back to the book of Joshua, which I finished reading last week and thoroughly enjoyed. Absolutely wonderful. Love Joshua. And in Joshua 15, verse 8, he refers to Gehinnom, the Valley of Hinnom, and also the Valley of the Sons of Hinnom. And this is also in Jeremiah and Isaiah. And so the Hebrew for Valley of Hinnom is Gehinnom, and the Greek equivalent for the New Testament, the same thing mentioned, is Gehenna. So they should put Valley of Hinnom. Now, I challenge you to find a translation which has done that, that has been consistent with Gehinnom and Gehenna. I edited a New Testament translation about 12 years ago, perhaps, and I told this fellow, this academic, that Gehenna is Valley of Hinnom, that he just put Gehenna. And I said, people won't know what that means. He said, yeah, I know it means Valley of Hinnom. I do know that. But people can, if they want to find out what it means, they can look it up and research it for themselves. I said, well, that's not your job as a translator. Your job as a translator is to tell them what it means. Tell them right now. But he wouldn't. He left it as Gehenna. So it should be Valley of Hinnom. But I don't know of any translation which has had the guts to do that, other than Keys of the Kingdom. When I first started this work in 1997, I realised straight away, this is going to take guts. And I thought, yeah, I don't care, I've got the guts, man. I certainly have. Let's get it right for God. Now, you can go onto Google Images or some other search engine and you can type in the Valley of Hinnom. And you will find that it is still there. It's outside Jerusalem. Now, it was where the Canaanites and some of the Israelites joined to make child sacrifices. They'd bang the drums so loud, the screams of the children couldn't be heard. How delightful, and it's still going on today. Not there, I don't think, but elsewhere. And it eventually became Jerusalem's perpetually burning garbage dump. And that's where they chucked the executed bodies of criminals. Now, in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, let's just turn to that, Matthew chapter 5, verse 22, you see more agenda and total lack of context, total lack of understanding of what this is about. So I get people saying, Jesus talked about hell. No one talked about hell more than Jesus. Jesus didn't mention hell even once ever in his life, other than to mock it in Luke 16, but we'll get to that. Matthew 5:22. Now, what's Jesus doing on the Sermon on the Mount? He is correcting the errors of the scribes who had made the word of God of no effect, void by their tradition. So Jesus was setting it straight. So he says first, verse 21, you have heard that it was said to the ancients, you shall not commit murder. Yes, right. Exodus 20, Deuteronomy 5, one of the Ten Commandments. And whoever murders will be liable to judgment. Yes, most certainly. So that's divine law. Then, next verse, Jesus goes on. But I say to you, everybody who becomes angry with his brother without a cause will be liable to judgment. And whoever says to his brother, empty head, nothing like this in the Old Testament, is there? Will be in danger of the Sanhedrin. Oh, it's not about divine judgment. It's about the local council. And whoever says to his brother, empty head, will be in danger of the Sanhedrin. Not God, but whoever says fool will be liable to the fire of the valley of Hinnom. So saying empty head is one thing. You know, you'll get hauled up before the local magistrates, but go as far as say fool and you'll be liable to the fire of the valley of Hinnom. In other words, have yourself executed and your dead body chucked on the city's perpetually burning rubbish dump. It's not about Jesus explaining hell. That is utter trash and delusion. Heavens, I'm glad these people aren't lawyers. You know, they'd execute you for a parking ticket. To say that Jesus here is speaking about hell, divine judgment, is utter trash. He's warning people how harsh the local council and magistrates are, and so better not go around insulting each other, because he then immediately warns them to be reconciled to each other. And he said something in Mark 9:50 as well. After the Valley of Hinnom warnings in Mark, he says, be at peace among each other. That's the point. Then you won't get hauled up between the hauled up by this evil local council. And it's about being chucked in the Valley of Hinnom by the council, being executed. It's nothing to do with hell. Oh dear, close reading. Read it, read what it says. And the other thing, never trust your King James Bible translation. And so notice also what it says, will be liable to the fire of the Valley of Hinnom. So in the King James, it says the fire of hell. Well, now, some people who are addicted to that Jacobean gobbledygook say, oh, well, when it says hell, it means the grave. Well, we've already seen that that's trash because they've made a distinction. And we've already also seen, and we can also see here it's trash because here it says the fire of the Valley of Hinnom. So in the King James, it's got the fire of hell. So if the grave is hell, is the grave, as they're saying, to justify it. What's this grave full of fire? The fire of the grave. About 6 years ago, my cousin from West Virginia, Andrew, came over here and we walked across the local heathland and we watched, it was a heat wave, and we watched a tree catch a light, spontaneous combustion. And then this tree, huge tree, was just burning. It just happened suddenly. And then the very ground around us, fire was coming out of the ground. And then the hedgerow along the road caught fire. We were standing there watching it, 50 yards from our feet, fire coming out of the ground. Incredible. And a lot of fire engines arrived in time and ran around putting it all out. But that does not happen in the graveyards, does it? Hell no, you King James addicts, does not mean grave. It does not. We've seen the distinction. Now let's go to Matthew 23 now. I love Matthew 23. Jesus begins by telling the scribes and Pharisees, you're sitting in Moses' seat. And of course he's meaning, you shouldn't even be here. Because they were guilty of the blood going back to Abel. Therefore, they were through the line of Cain. Because Herod was an Edomite and employed a chiefly Edomite priesthood. Not all of them, but in principle. And so, just going to find Matthew 23. Oh, excuse me. Matthew 23, verse 15. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! You go around sea and dry land to make one proselyte or convert, and when it's done, you make him twice as much a son of the valley of Hinnom as yourselves. Therefore, useless. Criminal. Fit to be chucked on the city's burning rubbish dump. What does the King James do? It puts hell. Make him a child of hell. They've removed the usefulness of Jesus' insult. Verse 33. Serpents, progeny of vipers, how can you escape from the judgment of the valley of Hinnom? The judgment of being executed as criminals and having your body burned on the local city's garbage dump, which is the Valley of Hinnom. But the King James, no, they've spoilt that. How can you escape the judgment of hell? You're going to burn in torments forever. But Jesus saying, how can you escape the judgment of the Valley of Hinnom? Well, they didn't, did they? Because AD 70, the city was set on fire. So that's exactly when it was fulfilled. So there were 1.1 million killed by the sword. So there would have been piles of bodies everywhere in these garbage dumps. But to say it's all about hell removes the historical context, the prophetic context, and the power of Jesus' insult. Jesus was saying, can you imagine standing in front of a line of bishops saying that you make your converts twice as much a child of the Valley of Hinnom as yourselves? You are fit to be chucked on a burning rubbish dump. Isn't that more powerful than saying, you know, go to hell? Because anyone can say that, you can say that in the street. So, that's Gehenna. Valley of Hinnom, it does not mean hell. It ain't hell. It's the Gehenom of Joshua 15, verse 8. It's the Gehenna, Valley of Hinnom of Matthew 5:22. Now, the third Greek word in the New Testament is Tartaru, which the Sons of Uselessness translated as cast down to hell. Now, Tartaru is not a noun, it's a verb. And it only occurs at Peter's second letter, chapter 2, verse I've got 24. That's not right, is it? It's 4, isn't it? Is it verse 4? Yeah, let's just check that. I don't like giving wrong references. Where is it? 2. No, that's 1 Peter. I should have known it by heart. It's 4. Yeah, verse 4. I wrote this about 4:30 this morning, sitting up in bed. So, let me just change that, my notes. Verse 4, I knew. Now, what's this about? What is this about? It's about 2 Peter 2, verse 4. It's about some rebels in the days of Moses, some sinners, some rebels rebelled against Moses, and he told them to stand by their tents, and they were swallowed underground in a pit. This is in Numbers 16, Numbers 26, it's repeated, Deuteronomy 11, Psalm 106, and in Jude 11. So it's mentioned several times in the Bible, and the principal men were called Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. They're mentioned in Jude and those other places. They were swallowed underground in a pit because of their rebellion. So they were not sinning angels, they were sinning messengers. And that word messengers is angelos. Now that is where we get angels from, yes. But also it's used for ordinary men, and it is used for messengers like John the Baptist. He was an angelos, a messenger. But it's used for ordinary men. In the passage about 1 Corinthians about women having head coverings, it says, because of the messengers, because of the angelos. It's spelt A-G-G in Greek, but it's pronounced A-N-G. That's how it's said, angelos. So because of the messengers, it's used for ordinary men. And this is what you have here. They were ordinary men who sinned. So they were sinning messengers who were swallowed underground in a pit. So, those are the impositions of hell that the sons of uselessness put into their perversions of the Bible. And they have made it a story of screaming angels in underground torture chambers, with, you know, devils and imaginary pitchforks that you import, imagery you import from those other cultural icons I mentioned at the beginning. Right, now then, what about Mark chapter 9, the worm that never dies? Oh yes, the worm that never dies. Well, well. This is just so comically easy, and all the hell lovers were thinking I'd avoid this. Here we are, Mark 9:43. If your hand causes you to stumble, it would be better to enter life maimed than having two hands to go into the valley of Hinnom, not hell, into the inextinguishable fire. Why was it inextinguishable? Because there were going to be 1.1 million bodies for a start. And also, it was a perpetually burning rubbish dump anyway. And where? Their worm does not die and the fire is not extinguished. Right, Jesus says that 3 times. The worm does not die and the fire is not extinguished. Well, we need to go to the source of that. Jesus was quoting Isaiah 66. And there's a chapter in here called The Immortal Worm. Isaiah 66:24, it's the last chapter of Isaiah. They will go out and look on carcasses of the men who transgressed against me, for their worm will not die, and their fire, nor will their fire be quenched, and they will be an object of disgust to all flesh. That's what Jesus was quoting from in Mark 9. But hold on, they make this into some hell. What does it start by saying? They will go out and look on carcasses. So they'll go out and look on their normal territory, and they will see from their place on the earth where they live, they'll see carcasses, dead bodies of those who transgressed against God. It's a prophecy about the destruction of Jerusalem. For their worm will not die. Why? Because there will be so many dead bodies to feast from. And there was a certain worm that feeds on bodies, and it's called the toligar, and that is this worm. And so there will be enough dead bodies for this worm, this toligar worm, to never die out. Simple as that. And that's what happened. That's the prophecy that was fulfilled. And so, nor will their fire be quenched, because there were just so many bodies. And they will be an object of disgust to all flesh. Oh, so everybody will be able to see them, all flesh. So this hell then, well, if this is hell and we can all see it, tell me, Pastor Johnny, where is it? We can all go and have a look. Let's all go and have a tour and look at all these people. Yes, well, because that's not what it's about, is it? It's about a coming destruction of piles of bodies, those who transgressed against God. And there were so many that there were enough flesh for these toligar worms to feast on, and enough bodies for the fire to go on and on in this never-extinguished rubbish heap or dump. At the end of that Mark 9 chapter, Jesus talks about another sort of fire. He says that some others, or rather everybody, will be salted with fire. Now this is testing, because God is a consuming fire. Deuteronomy 4:24 and Hebrews 12 verse 29. God is a consuming fire. Now Dr. Peter Bleuer, who a couple of years ago was kind enough to send me in the post some of his booklets. Now he's a maths genius, Dr. Peter Bleuer, and he's got a website called BibleMaths.com. And he's a Bible believer. And he has a wonderful phrase about this being salted with fire. He says it is to burn away the rottenness of their character. Now, I think that phrase is as good as anything in Shakespeare, and I've quoted it in here, acknowledging Peter, to burn away the rottenness of their character. And that's what testing is about, being tested with fire. Believe me, I've been tested with fire. Heavens, yes, I have. But I throw myself on God. And so something of the rottenness of my character, and God willing, is burned away. And I hope keeps being burned away. Right, then we have the lake of fire. Well, there was a lake of fire in Jerusalem in AD 70 for a start. And there was also so much blood that the blood was quenching the fire. But this also is a refining fire. In 1 Corinthians 3:15, Paul says, some will be saved, but as if through fire. but a destroying fire for others. But it is not an endless agony of torture by an unforgiving God. There is no such thing. Nor is it possible. What are we? We are flesh and bones. Yes, we have a character, which is our spirit, a nature that distinguishes us from another. So, for example, I'm not exactly the world's best at technology, but I have a friend who is. Well, I don't know about the world's best, but he is extremely good. And so then I'm good at other things. He's not. So we, and then perhaps I have certain emotional qualities that he doesn't have, and he has some that I have. We all have our character, and that is our spirit. It's not some detachable thing that flies off in a little silver casket to go to an underworld or an upper world. So Genesis 3:19, dust you are, and to dust you will return. Ezekiel 18 verse 4, the soul who sins will die. Oh, the soul dies, does it? I have here a document, my Aeonian document number 349, the dying soul, the soul is mortal. And I've got 45 passages showing that there is no consciousness in the grave. So what one did I mark here? Psalm 103 verse 19. Why did that attract me? He understands our formation. He remembers that we are dust. The days of man are like grass, like a flower of the field he flourishes. For the wind passes over it and there is no sign of it, and its place will recognize it no more. That's that was verses 14 to 16. Yeah, that's what I meant to put. Yeah. Psalm 30 verse 9. What profit in my blood? In my going down to a pit, will the dust praise you? Will it declare your truth? Psalm 6 verse 5. There is in death no remembrance of you. Who in the grave is going to give you thanks? Isaiah 38, 18. The grave cannot praise you. Death cannot celebrate you. 45 passages I have. And there will be others. So what is the gospel? It's a gospel of resurrection. It's not a gospel of eternal soul. A gospel of resurrection. Where from? The grave. From hell? No. From paradise? No. From out of airy nothing? No. It's resurrection out of the grave. That is the gospel. Though we die, we can be raised by God. 2 Corinthians 1, 9, God raises the dead. John 5, 28 to 29, Jesus said, there will be an hour is coming when those who are in the graves will hear my voice and they will rise, some to a resurrection of life and some to a resurrection of judgment. He's talking about believers. And John 11, 26, whoever is living and believing in me will most certainly not die throughout the eon. Those who are believing in him. And Martha said to him of her brother Lazarus, I know he will rise in the last day. Not I know his soul has gone to heaven or any such garbage. Right, what about Luke 16 then? Oh, Jesus describing hell. Oh, thank you. At last we've got the description of the man, from the man, of what hell is really like. Have we? The parable of Lazarus. which can be found in Homer's Odyssey. A man called Tantalos, who's in torment in flames and yearns for water, and it keeps being taken from him, from where we get tantalizing, tantalize. And it's in Edmund Spenser's Fairy Queen, contemporary of Shakespeare, a wonderful poet, and of course another fiction like Milton's Paradise Lost that draws on many classical stories. Spenser's not projecting this as truth. It's a fiction story. And so it got circulated from Homer and the ancients into the teachings of the scribes and the Pharisees, so that the poor man went to paradise and the rich man suffered torments. It says in the King James, the rich man woke up in Hades, lifted his eyes. I think it says he lifted his eyes in Hades. It's like you die and you wake up in Hades, and in hell, rather. I've translated it as Hades to make it a mockery of the ancient mythological story. And so, yeah, tantalized, you can't get water. And it's Abraham's bosom where the Lazarus was supposed to be. That's a fiction. I mean, all this stuff, it's out of Kabbalah and mythology. And the physics of it is nonsense. How can you burn forever? How can Lazarus, how could he have seen Abraham? If there are billions of these people in hell, how could they call across to all the billions who are in heaven, this chasm? How can everybody do it? No, the Pharisees were money lovers, and they told this story to stop complaints about being fleeced, to stop complaints about being poor. Now, some see this story as a parable of the house of Judah. But when Jesus, I can see where they get it from. Yes, it does make sense in the way they describe it, but there's something against it. And that is that when Jesus told parables, he used real things. So wheat, tares, fish, journeys, a sower, farmer, soil, lost coins, fields, stewards, moths, trees. He didn't make up fictional things that might delude people into thinking hell is real. So Jesus was mocking this hell thing. He wasn't teaching it. And in the end, he said, believe Moses and the prophets. And that stuff's not in Moses and the prophets. So also this description of this fictional hell is in one of my editions of Josephus, but it's not necessarily written by Josephus. It's uncertain authorship, but it is a description of this hell based on Luke 16. So it is somebody after the time of Jesus took it from Jesus and wrote it as if this is what you've got coming if you don't believe what we tell you. So now, finally, the hell teachers, they have got a problem, haven't they? First of all, they've got a problem in their character. Well, no, first they've got a problem in that they've read fake translations, they've read perversions, and they've believed them. But I had that problem, so I understand. But when somebody came along to tell me the truth, I accepted the evidence. I spent a week reading it and accepted the evidence. And I was thrilled. But those who continue and are disinterested in the evidence, they've got a problem of character because they want this thing to be true. and they screech insults at us. And why, yes, somebody last Tuesday even wanted me and Richard Vobes to suffer it. So they certainly have got a problem. But then they've got another problem. If they were to listen to the evidence that it's not in the Bible, that it's evil translating, then they would have to start thinking, what else then in the Bible might they have made a mistake about? What else am I deluded about? How else have I been deceived? Well, I'm here to tell you pretty much everything, Major. Pretty much everything. So that's why I shall be in Michigan, let's get it right, not Michigan, Michigan, on Saturday, November the 9th, for a day of Bible teaching and worship with my friend Dr. Rose Stevens, who's providing some worship in spirit and truth. And so on the top of my description box below this video, you will see a link to Nikki's newsletter. And if you go onto her link there, you can scroll down her newsletter and see how she set out for you all the timings and the details, the events. And so if you can come along, please do. We would absolutely love to see you. And this foundation for the teaching of organic and grammatical truth. And so that the Lord God of Israel, can be worshipped in spirit and truth. I've got a final word for that pastor in the devil's punch bowl who told me my parents were going to hell, but who are now in the grave. Pastor Johnny, has anybody seen my parents, Ray and Peggy Sparks? Death strokes were their deaths to me, their noble minds and hearts. Pastor Johnny called for a walk. All seemed hospitable and well. But down in the devil's punch bowl, he said, my parents will go to hell. Down in the devil's punch bowl in Surrey near his home, he said, my parents are going to hell, their beliefs not being his own. Twisting and writhing in fire, in agony from kindly God, they will never be forgiven. That's where my mum and dad have gone. Now Pastor Johnny's carked it too, cut down by death's early strike. So, if hell is real, you little wolf, tell us what it's like. Pastor Johnny is in the grave, and that is where my parents are, in the grave. The character of God is in Psalm 63, verse 3. His loving kindness is better than life. And I live in that daily, and I pray in that way for my much loved brothers and sisters. Praise be to his mighty name. He is good to us. Live in it, enjoy in it, revel in it. God is good to us. He is kind. He is forgiving. He is forgiving. A just God. Praise his wonderful name.